In the wake of Britain's decision to leave the EU, the rest of Europe is weighing up its options. My guest here in the German city of Potsdam is Günter Verheugen. He was a vice president of the European Commission and one of its former commissioners. Can Europe reunify, or will it now fall apart in bitterness and division? Günter Verheugen, welcome to Conflict Zone. A lot of apocalyptic warnings in the last few days about what Brexit will mean. Even you said before the referendum, we're looking into the precipice. Is the EU so fragile?
Yes, it is. Since a couple of years, we cannot deny the fact that there are clear tendencies of dissolution. We have tendencies of renationalization. In many countries.
But some of the statements made are clearly over the top. I mean, we had Donald Tusk, President of the European Council, saying, as a historian, I fear Brexit could be the beginning of the destruction, not only of the EU, but of Western civilization. This is hysterical, isn't it?
That goes too far, and I wouldn't say nonsense if my friend Donald Tusk says something.
But you talked about the precipice as well, didn't you? Why is it a precipice?
It is beyond me. Because it means that for the first time in the history of the European integration project, there is a country that will leave instead of join. What we have experienced over many
years. This is the thing with clubs. You either stay in the club or you leave, don't you?
I'm very sorry, but the European Union is not a club. That is a big misunderstanding. Obviously, a very common British misunderstanding. It's not a club. The European Union is a family of nations that wish to decide their future and the destiny together, because they know.
But clearly, here's one that doesn't.
Because they know that we can survive in the world of tomorrow only if we stand together. And I'm very sure the British people will feel that very soon.
But they don't feel it now. And the 17 million, more than 17 million people voted to leave. So they don't want your club. I know you don't like the word club, but they don't like it anymore. They don't want it. It doesn't work for them.
It's a democratic decision. It has to be accepted. And the European Union clearly is not a prison. If you want to leave it, you can leave it, whether there is an exit clause in the treaty or not. There is an exit clause that regulates procedures. But if you wish, you can leave.
Whether it is wise or not,
whether it is in the best interest of the country, is a different question. Majorities have, legally speaking, majority has always the right on its side.
Okay, but instead of saying to the British, we're going to work with you, yes, you're outside the European Union, everything will be fine, we'll have a good working professional relationship, the EU reacts like a jilted lover. You've had Jean-Claude Juncker saying, this is not an amicable divorce, and it was not a tight love affair anyway. In other words, we never liked you anyway, so go.
I fully agree. And you are not accusing me, because I was the first here to criticize the reactions of European leaders. We should really not discuss revenge or punishment or whatever. We should not give the impression that we want now the divorce as soon as possible. But we have to say this is your decision, we have to respect it, and now we have to find a solution how we can make sure that the best interests of both sides are served.
But you say you criticize the EU.
Yeah, I criticize it heavily.
But this kind of arrogance has been in the Commission for a very long time. It was certainly there when you were in the Commission. You were a very senior official. I mean, you can criticize it all you want now, but you were part of this machine, weren't you?
I think I was the one, I was the first to make the point that we cannot continue like this. You may remember perhaps that I have initiated the huge program of deregulation and reduction of bureaucracy, that I was the one who said, we do not need to regulate so many things. We can do less and less.
Just but so even when you were
I can give you a lot of help.
But even when you were there in the commission.
No, you accused me. You said,
no, I'm not accusing you.
No, you said I was a member of that body and you did the same. And I say, I did not. I have seen the problem. I have tried to change. Of course, I know that perhaps I should have done more, but I did what I could.
But there was this aversion to democracy within the EU when you were there. I mean, you look at this reaction now.
Sorry,
no, excuse me. Can I just get the question out? You look at this reaction to what is a democratic vote, an expression of the democratic will of the British people. Berlin doesn't like that. Brussels doesn't like that, the expression of democracy. They didn't like the Dutch referendum, so they overrode that. They didn't like the Greek referendum on the bailout, so they forced the government to go against the wishes of their people. This hasn't just emerged in Brussels. This has been going on for years, this feeling that we don't want to hear the words of the people. We just want the governments to do as they're told by Brussels.
I cannot,
and you were part of that machine as well.
I cannot deny that happened. That referenda in smaller countries, yeah.
Oh, you wouldn't push the big ones around, would you?
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
You wouldn't push the big ones around.
Exactly. I criticize that.
So kick the little ones in the teeth.
Ireland is a typical example. If the Irish did it twice or even three times, rejected a treaty, but then it was said, you can try again. Some minor changes were done, and so in the case of France, 2005, when the constitution was rejected, it was clear the project is dead. So I agree, there is a lack of respect for democratic decisions. That's number one. But number two,
so it's more Soviet Union than European Union, isn't it? You don't know the difference.
No, absolutely not.
Countries have to stay in line. Countries have to do as they're told.
You said that the Commission, for instance, has no democratic legitimacy. I tell you that I, as a member of the European Commission twice, was nominated by a democratically elected government, was appointed by a democratically elected president, was grilled by the European Parliament hours and hours, and was finally endorsed by a vote of the European Parliament. A member of the British cabinet, yeah, is simply appointed by the Prime Minister. There's no parliamentary involvement at all. The same, by the way, here in Germany. So it's simply not true to say that European institutions are not democratically organized. The problem is, and the misunderstanding, people expect the European Union to be organized and to act like a state, but it is not a state. It is not a state.
It is a corporation of governments. Günter Verheugen, for years, it has ignored the growing unpopularity of its own institutions, and a bloc, supposedly the richest and most successful, the largest trading bloc in the world, ignores sky-high unemployment among some of its citizens. What is it?
I couldn't.
One fifth of those under 25 are unemployed in this star trade
Could you tell me what the British government and the British Parliament, as members of this club, still today, what they have done to fight against this? I fully share your view that this is a shame and a scandal. That the job creation in the European Union is not the number one issue. It is, by the way, it is in the treaty. Yeah? The treaty says that full employment is an objective of the European Union, and I would have expected that policy would be mainstreamed to achieve that. That did not happen. Why did
but
it
But the
not?
European Union took no account
no,
of
I
this.
Have to tell you why it
took
didn't
no
happen.
Account of
it
this.
Didn't happen because we have completely different philosophies of economic policy in the European Union. On one side, we have Germany and, so far, the United Kingdom, yeah, fighting for a market-based policy, economic policy, competitiveness, no state interventionism, no protectionism. That is Germany and the UK.
Yeah.
On the other side, you have the Southerners, You have France and you have the majority.
So it's not a union at all.
It's a disunion, isn't it? This is the reality.
Disunity everywhere you look.
Excuse me. This is the reality in Europe, that you have different countries with different priorities, different histories, different experiences, and different needs. And the art is to bring it together.
Look at the growing unpopularity. In the latest polls carried out by the Pew survey, only 27% of Greeks, only 38% of the French, and 47% of the Spanish have a favorable opinion of the union.
Yeah, that's pretty good.
Only 38% of the French, founding member of the European Union, only 38% like it.
Yeah, that's well known.
That's a huge blow. Yeah,
what is your answer now? Shall we blow it in air? Shall we give it up?
Maybe it's time for that. If it doesn't work for people.
No, it is time
for... It doesn't work for the clients, does it?
It is time for far-reaching reforms. It's time for change.
They've been talking about that for years. These are just words, Günter Verheugen.
You must not accuse me. I am the
They're
one...
They're just words.
No, please don't accuse me. You are speaking with the one who has supported the British view from the first day. I was the one who said, when Mr. Cameron sent his letter to his colleagues, precisely naming the issues which have to be dealt with: flexibility, subsidiarity, efficiency of spending, less bureaucracy, more transparency. I have always supported that. So please do not accuse me. Let us discuss.
But it's like writing on the wall. People stop reading it. It's been said so often, but nothing was done.
We need to discuss the question how we can change that. No need to discuss the question who is responsible for it. There's nobody here in this room who is responsible for that. So we need to discuss what must be changed. And first question perhaps, why did it happen? What is the reason for this? And I could give many reasons, but one of the reasons is clearly that we have an economic crisis since 2008. That we have effects of globalization, which does not only create winners, but they are also losers everywhere in our country. They feel frustrated.
And you have the migrant crisis.
Exactly.
Which has accelerated people's dislike of the European Union.
Exactly. That came on
top. Hasn't it?
That came on top of it.
I mean, look at the proportion of people who dislike the handling of the migrant crisis. In every single country of the EU, overwhelming majorities disapprove of Brussels' handling. Greece, it's 94%, Sweden, 88%, Italy, 77%, disapprove of these policies.
I belong to those who disapprove. Yeah.
And they just keep pushing them through. Yeah. We have to abide by the policy. So when you talk about the need for reform, we've heard all this over years of the need for reform.
Right.
When is it going to happen?
Right, and perhaps it needs something.
When is it going to happen?
Perhaps it needs something that happened in the United Kingdom to make them aware, what they have done, and to make them aware what they have to do. Perhaps it is a healthy shock. I don't know.
And we have the French foreign minister right after the results saying, for a long time we've been aware that we must make Europe more attractive, as if he thinks he should put a bunch of flowers in the metro station or something to make it look more attractive. They don't get it, do they?
Yeah.
They don't get it. Does the EU deserve to survive if people don't get it?
To put it very bluntly, I think that with the present leadership in national governments and in European institutions, we will not find a solution, and there's a clear risk that we will not survive as an European Union with the present. Because
you think there's a clear danger the European Union will not survive?
Yes, absolutely.
That other countries will leave?
Yes. Yes, I can give you the candidates. I mean, the Netherlands,
Italy,
Austria. No, Italy, I won't think so. Sweden, perhaps. Denmark is a clear candidate. And not the Central and Eastern European countries. That's always a misunderstanding. The Central and Eastern European countries are very, very keen to preserve their sovereignty, but they're also very keen to be members of the European Union and to have an effective European Union with projects, programs, and money to spend. So I don't think that risk is in that part of Europe, but Austria, the Netherlands, Denmark, perhaps Ireland. And
perhaps the Commission should resign. The Slovaks have suggested that Jean-Claude Juncker, President of the European Commission, resign. Should he, as far as you're concerned?
No, I don't think that it's useful to blame one of the institutions or a single person. Juncker is clearly not responsible for that, what happened in the UK. I mean, what happened in the UK?
No, but he's responsible for a commission that's been, by his own words, meddling far too much in the affairs of individual member countries. Well, he said
My understanding is that Juncker understands the problem and that he tries to change.
Here's a man who said we are interfering in too many domains of EU citizens' private lives.
Right.
And what did he do about it? Nothing.
Right.
We are losing economic clout in a very visible way. We are no longer respected in our countries when we emphasize the need to give priority to the EU.
Yeah.
I mean, to come out with that, the next sentence is, and I resign accordingly. Shouldn't that be the next sentence?
He started with some interesting ideas. He reshaped the way how the Commission works, and he made it very clear that he wants that the Commission concentrates on the really important issues and not all these thousand minor things.
Don't you think that people would be more satisfied with the Commission if it just stopped wasting as much money as it actually does? Last November, we had the Court of Auditors saying this is the watchdog for the Commission, saying 6.3 billion euros had been misspent over the last year. 6.3 billion, is that acceptable in an age of austerity?
This figure is a little bit misleading. It does not say that the money was wasted. It says that there were errors
misspent.
I know the language of this institution because I was 10 years working with it. The language of the institution.
And it was wasting money when you were there as well, wasn't it?
In all those cases, there were sometimes very, very minor errors in the administration of the funds. But it does not mean that the money was spent in an illegal.
But the Court of Auditors was chucking the accounts back at the Commission.
Sorry, what you're telling here is one of the stories, well-known stories, which we know from the British mass media. In reality, the level of corruption or fraud that you have, you spend by Brussels institutions, which is a very, very small part of it. The money is spent by member states. The money is not spent by the European institutions. Is very, very, very marginal. So this is not. There are many points.
You say it's marginal, but the court's president said last year we cannot afford to do business as usual.
I have said that already.
All right.
Yes.
Enlargement. This is something that you were responsible for. And you were one of the loudest voices supporting Turkey's
membership. Supported by the British government and the British public.
Yeah, but you were also one of the largest voices supporting Turkey's membership.
Yes, even also supported by the British government.
I understand that, but isn't it time to admit you were wrong? About Turkey.
Absolutely
it's
not.
A human rights disaster.
In the contrary, my friend. This is a good question, yeah? Why have we seen this change in Turkey, change to the worse? Since when did the policy of reform in Turkey change? End of 2005. And why did it happen? It happened because at the end of 2005 we had change of government in Berlin, we had a change of policy in Paris, and the policy of the European Union, which so far was crystal clear and said we want Turkey as a full member, policy was unclear, mixed signals were sent to Turkey. Germany.
Let me take issue with you on this because you're attributing responsibility to the EU for a man who jails journalists on false charges, closes newspapers, shoots Syrian refugees at the borders, beats up demonstrators, hundreds of police.
I say.
And you say it's the European Union's fault that he behaves in this appalling way.
The reason why that could happen is that European Union, including the UK, lost leverage in Turkey. Until 2005, there was a lot of leverage. I was able to call Mr. Erdogan and tell him, you're not going to do this, because then the result will be that accession negotiations will not start and will not be concluded. And when Turkey got the signal, whatever they do, at the end of the day, they will not be accepted as members. There was no reason for Mr. Erdogan to follow the advice and wishes from Brussels. I'm not saying that
people in Brussels. He never had any intention of following that advice.
This is not.
He never had any intention of it.
This is simply not true.
Well, here's the proof.
No, this is simply
not true. Here's the proof. Locking up journalists, locking up prosecutors, judges, anybody who's come into contact with him and has put suspicion on him.
I'm very sorry, you don't know. Obviously, you don't know the history. Between 2002 and 2005,
we're looking at the present, and if the EU had a shred, I tried to explain
why this the country that was moving to the right direction, yeah, and especially the area between 2002 and 2005, the first government of Mr. Erdogan, was the strongest reform-oriented government I have seen in Europe at this time. At this time, and then it changed. And I asked the question, why did it change?
Yeah, and because you blame the EU.
Definitely, I do.
And suddenly they turned the EU turned Erdogan into the monster that he is today. This is what you're saying.
No, did not.
They're responsible for his change of policy.
That is what you are
saying.
That's what you are saying. What I said is that we gave the room that made it possible for him to do so.
The fact is, once it became clear that he was behaving in this manner and that Turkey no longer respects human rights, if the EU had a shred of self-respect, it would get up from the table, walk away and say, we're not dealing with you anymore. But it doesn't do that, does it?
Nobody does. Nobody has the courage to say it is senseless. We stopped it because nobody wants to be responsible at answering the question, who lost Turkey for the Western camp? I mean, Turkey is much more than a question for the European
Union. Turkey was never in the Western camp anyway. Maybe you overestimated your powers. Maybe you overestimated your influence here.
Maybe, but I know from our American allies that for them, Turkey is one of the most important strategic countries of the world. And that the Americans, and the Brits, your country, always said it is absolutely necessary to anchor Turkey firmly in Euro-Atlantic structures. Yeah, and I think that's right. If I look at the map and see which important role Turkey plays in that region and how important it is for us, that Turkey will not be like Saudi Arabia or Syria.
It's not anchored now. It's very definitely.
No, unfortunately not.
And nor are other members like the Balkans, for instance, where the EU has invested a lot of money and got back crime, organized crime, trafficking of people, trafficking of drugs, trafficking of weapons. That's been the result of the EU's investment in the Balkans, hasn't it?
You think that the lack of political culture and the lack of civic culture in those countries is a result of the policy of the EU?
It happened during the EU's negotiations with them.
You think it did not exist before? And
the reason
why the Western Balkan countries were given a membership perspective in 1999 was the fact that there was a war, a terrible war, and a strategy was needed to make sure that it would come to an end. And the view at this time was, and I think it's still the right view, was give them a perspective to become part of the European integration process, and in return...
But it's not going in the right direction,
not
is
everywhere,
it?
Not everywhere.
Look at Kosovo. As the New York Times reported last month, extremist clerics and secretive associations funded by Saudis have transformed the once tolerant Muslim society into a font of extremism.
Don't tell me about Kosovo. I know that very well.
Yeah, well, look at the EU. EU's failure there.
I see progress in the most important country in that region, that is Serbia.
Progress in Bulgaria since 2007. 2007. Organized crime is a threat to its sovereignty and to European unity. The Commission wrote that last year.
Yeah, this.
So it's going in the wrong direction.
In some countries, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah,
want all this enlargement to continue.
Would you think that the situation in these countries would be better if you would have left them out in the cold, in a political no man's land?
But how does it benefit the security of the EU to give them visa-free travel? Let all this crime into the EU.
The reason for offering Bulgaria and Romania the membership was that without Bulgaria and Romania, you cannot stabilize the whole area, and you cannot create, you cannot guarantee peace in that part of Europe. And so far, they have delivered. I share your view. There are still many, many deficiencies, still a lot to do. It's disappointingly slow, the process of democratic civilization. But I wouldn't agree to say that it is not moving in the right direction. If I see in Romania and Bulgaria...
So you think the EU, even having lost Britain as a member, should push forward with enlargement? Never mind the poor results.
It does not seem so. It does not seem so. You know that the policy of the present Commission is very clear. No accession during our term, and there is no country that is close to accession. I don't think that enlargement is on the agenda for the European Union right now. But the question is, can we really argue that being part of European integration is an exclusive right for some countries, and other nations have not the right to participate? It would be very difficult for me to explain why the Germans can be part of it. And the Romanians cannot.
Günter Verheugen, we have to leave it there. Thanks very much for being on Conflict Zone.